Hi, this is Annie Dance. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops and Congress newsletter, where I work to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. Today, Saturday, August 3rd, 2024, I'm going to give you an update on what's going on with the manhunt for Ryan Ricky Houston. So, yesterday, on Friday, you may have seen McDowell County Sheriff's Office put out a statement with a BOLO alert, be on the lookout alert for Ryan Ricky Houston. And when my internet cooperates, I will go to the full post, but they are looking for him in connection to an incident, basically a home invasion. And I believe they even called it that in their release. And just as a caveat, this is going to be a mix of both news and commentary. So please take that into account when considering what I'm speaking about today. So again, yesterday, the McDowell County Sheriff's Office stated that they are searching for Ryan Ricky Houston. Officials are searching for him, a 41-year-old white male, for felony warrants out of McDowell County. Houston is the subject of a home invasion that occurred in McDowell County shortly before midnight. So that was Friday night. Houston, who is currently out on bond for attempted first-degree murder and assault on law enforcement in Buncombe County, forced his way into a home in McDowell County, assaulted the homeowner, and stole a firearm and vehicle. This stolen vehicle was located a short time later on Interstate 40 near Exit 90. It is believed Houston then broke into Skyline Marine off Exit 90 of Interstate 40 and stole a 2016 Chevrolet Silverado 2500 truck. The Skyline Marine store is actually called Skyline Lake James, I saw on their website. The truck is navy blue in color, crew cab, 4-door, 4x4 LTZ. On the back glass of the truck is the wording Skyline Marine, Honda, and Fastcat with tag number HE7004. Warrants have been obtained on Houston, and he is currently being sought by law enforcement. Houston is believed to be armed and dangerous. If anyone sees this vehicle or Houston, please use caution. Do not approach. Contact law enforcement immediately. Anyone with information may contact Captain Shannon Smith at McDowell County Sheriff's Office at 828-652-2235 or their local 911 center if an emergency. Attached is a photo of Houston. Immediate inquiries can be directed to Tiffany Coates, 828-652-2235, extension 1254. Here are photos of Houston and the truck. So keep that in mind. That was yesterday on Friday. Now on Saturday afternoon, there's been developments of what happened last night. The town of Marshall is grieving the tragic loss of retired Chief Boone in a crash that may or may not be related to Houston. More on that in just a moment. But first, I want to give you some more background on Houston and his prior arrests. The Asheville Citizen Times stated that a quote, dangerous man in fatal wreck before home invasion and ankle monitor stopped working. So you saw from the McDowell County Sheriff's Office that they're looking for Houston, but they didn't describe who was in the car with Houston. I'm learning more about that today. So according to the Citizen Times, local and state law enforcement are searching for Ryan Ricky Houston. Again, with those details from the McDowell County Sheriff's Office that I just discussed. Now, they say before the home invasion, Houston's black 4-door Mercedes sedan was seen about 10 p.m. speeding at an excess of 100 miles per hour while traveling Interstate 40 in McDowell County, according to an August 2nd court filing. A North Carolina State Highway Patrol trooper attempted to catch the sedan and initiate a traffic stop. Again, currently out on bond for those previous charges. It was related to shooting with a Buncombe County Sheriff's deputy. Houston's ankle monitor device was, quote, cut off and/or stopped tracking at 10:03 p.m. based on information in court records from Buncombe County Pretrial Services. Houston's monitor was paired with a tether brake phone that was later discovered in McDowell County. The ankle monitor has not been found. The trooper in the pursuit of Houston's sedan discovered the car was involved in an accident near the Parker Paget Road exit off I-40. The trooper saw Houston and a woman near the Mercedes at the crash site. The woman was, quote, showing signs of injury and needed immediate medical attention, according to the court filing. Now, while the trooper attended to the woman, Houston fled the scene, according to court records. There's no indication whether he fled on foot or in a vehicle. The woman was taken by ambulance to a nearby hospital where she was, quote, declared dead on arrival. The Citizen Times did not release the name because it's not confirmed if her next of kin has been notified. After the accident, law enforcement say Houston forced his way into a home in McDowell County, assaulted the homeowner, and stole a firearm vehicle. So that incident with Mercedes was prior to the home invasion. Now, I've learned further details about that the woman was actually stabbed. The trooper thought that she was sustained injuries in a crash, but it turns out that Houston allegedly stabbed her. So Houston allegedly stabbed her and killed her. The McDowell County Sheriff's Office again has obtained felony warrants and he's being sought by law enforcement. So these Buncombe County charges, in a separate incident, Houston was charged with shooting a deputy outside the Buncombe County detention facility in May 2023. He got out on bond from the jail after being charged with attempted first-degree murder and assault on a law enforcement officer with a firearm on May 10, 2023. He was released on bond twice for these charges, once on August 1st, 2023, after posting his original $1.5 million bond, and he was arrested 6 days later for a pretrial release violation and given a $2.7 million bond, which he posted and was released August 17th, 2023. On November 27th, Buncombe County Judge Jacqueline Grant ordered Houston was allowed to leave Buncombe County for work purposes only with prior approval from pretrial release, according to court documents. The August 2nd court filing is for a motion to revoke Houston's bond by District Attorney Todd Williams' office. The motion said Houston presents a clear disregard to the order of the court to follow the electronic monitoring provisions of pretrial release and the greater law in general. Assistant District Attorney Kyle Sherrard argued Houston's behavior poses a risk of danger to himself and the greater public. Houston still awaits trial in Buncombe County after authorities said he walked into the lobby of a jail at 20 Davidson Drive in downtown Asheville around 1:40 a.m. on May 7, 2023, and started communicating threats to his wife, according to a civil summons document. Sheriff's Deputy William Johnson, who was suing Houston, attempted to speak with him and de-escalate the situation, but Houston became further enraged with the deputy, according to the court document. When Johnson and APD officer Megan Hansford approached to arrest him, Houston resisted arrest and an altercation ensued, according to a sheriff's office news release. Houston produced a firearm and shot Johnson in the shoulder. Johnson returned fire and struck Houston, who fled the scene. Houston was later taken into custody at Mission Hospital around 2:29 a.m., May 7th, according to police logs. A record or request rather for a domestic violence protective order filed with Houston's wife shortly after his arrest states Houston had a pattern of threatening to use the violence with a firearm and other threats. Children have witnessed altercations as well as continued arguments and nonstop calling. I assume that means name calling, the or perhaps phone calling, the complaint said. So that was that reporting. Now let's move on to what the court documents actually say. So this document, dated August 2nd, 2023, is for a hearing for Houston, I believe, to appear on those charges. Let me, or motion to revoke bond. I think they got the date wrong. Let's see. The date on this is, yep, they got the date wrong on their little stamp there. Or maybe that's from, I'm confused. Just a moment. Let's see. Al Sherard. Interesting. Anyway, okay, yes, that was last year. My let me this is I don't understand why the court has these like blank pages. It doesn't really make sense to me, but at any rate, so that's one court document talking about the release of the bond that we just talked about. But then WLS, the ABC affiliate, reported that in, and we'll make sure I get the date correct on this. Bottom line, from as I speak currently, law enforcement is still seeking Ryan Houston. I have no other confirmed knowledge from law enforcement. They have not confirmed that they have taken into custody or anything else about him. So keep that in mind, like I said, in a moment. So this news article from last year, Friday, August 4th, 2023, from the ABC affiliate stated that the court documents show a history of violence, substance abuse, and death threats in the case of a Weaverville man charged with shooting a deputy in May. So I'll try to, excuse me, skim this, but what's interesting is they posted the actual documents on Scribd, which is kind of a sub. I use Document Cloud, I don't use Scribd, but when you click download this PDF, this is very telling. Shows us when I clicked on it earlier, it showed that, yep, the document has been removed from Scribd. I don't know why it's been removed, but that was very interesting. However, it still appears on the WLOS page as of right now. I'm going to try to zoom in so we can read it together and get an archival history because I have a healthy distrust for everything, and I don't believe that this will live here forever. So let's document it and have a archive of what actually happened and what it says as of today. So this is a domestic violence order protection consent order, and I believe this is dated in 2020. Let's see, 2023. So because it would have been affected for a year, and now it does show that the petitioner plaintiff was Laura Houston, who is his wife, I believe. I believe they're separated. I haven't seen anything to the effect stating that they are divorced. Although one other journalist called her his ex-wife. So either way, in these court documents, basically she detailed what the defendant what she says the defendant did, such as following her to a friend's home, broke into the home, assaulted the plaintiff's friend, followed her to the magistrate's office, and shot a deputy. So that was May 6th to 7th, 2023. He has guns. He shot an officer. It states he may be suicidal. Most of it happened while, can't make that out, while kids were present at the home. I don't know why they don't allow this to be typed rather than handwritten. It's very difficult to read handwriting now. It states children have witnessed altercations as well as continued arguments and nonstop calling. Emotional injury is underlined. It states he stated to me, "Till death do us part," on phone conversation, May 1st, 2023. Death is underlined. The defendant has made threats to commit suicide. It is checked, and there's several other things checked on this other document. It states notice of voluntary dismissal from 2022 from a prior document So I read several documents, and I believe they have all of them here that I'll go through. But basically, his wife or ex-wife would fill out these documents and then withdraw them from the court. It has a history of that. So this document states on August 7th, 2022, that the plaintiff's son, the defendant is plaintiff, yeah, plaintiff, the defendant is drinking heavily and being abusive towards the kids and her. It states that he threw a bowl of food at her during an argument. It states that he has guns all over the home. It states he is suicidal. He has threatened to kill her if she leaves. It states that he screams and yells constantly. Let's see, it stated that it's difficult to read. Defendant. There's several other boxes checked, but you can, if this still lives there was no way for me to download it and upload it to my site without doing screenshots. That's really quite a lengthy process, but this is, this is a FCC website, so they really shouldn't be deleting documents. I hope it stays there, but again, as of today, this document is publicly accessible. And of course, it's publicly accessible from the court. Again, it states that the defendant, Ryan Houston, has, quote, a small arsenal. There are handguns and rifles and automatic guns throughout the house, knives, bows, and arrows. It states he has threatened to kill me if I ever leave him. And then a very lengthy timeline is follows. August 2018, arrested with a firearm in bunkum. Spring 2019, went to Nashville, mixed pills and alcohol. Received phone call from a hotel employee around 2 a.m. stating Ryan was drunk and didn't know where he was staying. To keep the police from being involved, I used credit card to purchase a room for Ryan to stay in to sleep it off. Summer 2019, trip to Key Largo, Florida, gave me a black eye by throwing a suitcase at me. Leaving Key Largo, Florida, Ryan got into the quote locked Vrbo liquor cabinet and got drunk, verbally assaulted me and yelled at me the entire ride to the airport. March 2020, wrecked his car into a tree from drinking and driving, ran from police and fire rescue. April 2020, overdosed on fentanyl in bathroom while I was out. Upon arriving home, I had to kick the bathroom door to get to him. 4 days later, he overdosed again in the basement. I sent him by ambulance to hospital and got an IVC order, that's involuntary commitment order, to have him committed until I could get him into rehab. His doctors, MD at St. Joseph Hospital, would not release him to me so I could take him to rehab because of the way he verbally assaulted me via phone calls. I had to pay thousands of dollars to hire a professional driver to drive him. He was kicked out of the first rehab due to an altercation with another patient. I had to find another rehab to put him in. April 2021, trip to Mexico. Ryan got drunk and chased his oldest son because his son expressed his concern for Ryan's drinking. August 2022, Ryan continues to mentally abuse me due to his dissatisfaction of my time spent with children, church, housework versus working for his business. August, I believe it says August 2022. My 14-year-old was, this is difficult to read, it's kind of faded. 14-year-old was doing something and he began to put a frozen pizza in the oven, but got yelled at by Ryan for using the microwave timer instead of the oven timer. I gave Ryan a look to tell him to calm down. He then began to yell at me that it was his house and he would speak to his children how he saw fit. I yelled back that he needed to calm down. It was our house too, and he couldn't speak to him that way. Ryan then threw a bowl of food at me. He shut himself in our 4 and 8-year-old's room and told the kid's mom was psycho. And there's more information that's difficult to read. It's faded. August 10th, 2022. Ryan drove to my parents' house. Were unannounced looking for me and continues to harass my father through text messages and calls demanding to know where we are. Drove to my grandmother's house to look for me, looking for me. August 2022, threatened to remove the kids from our church to humble me. And then it states we are married. Children have witnessed their father drunk. Children have experienced their father irritated and irate. He has stated that he would blow his brains out on numerous occasions. There's several redacted items. Then it states Ryan at that point was yelling to our children to get out of the car and back into the house. Ryan attempted to grab my car keys, but realized they were not in the car. I was able to get my children safely in the car and drove off. Ryan at that point got into his vehicle and chased us. One of our employees called 911 to protect me and my children. He currently has warrants out for his arrest and is an avid alcoholic. I fear for my children's safety around him while he is drinking. Ryan has a terrible temper and believes he is above the law. Ryan also has a prescription for Xanax in which he mixes with alcohol. So those are the court documents, again, that are publicly available. So, and now then, Deputy Johnson, the one who Houston allegedly shot, he is actually suing Houston. So the civil lawsuit filed August 2nd, 2023, misspells Johnson last name, but states that the subject matter venue, it states the plaintiff is a citizen resident of Madison County, and it states that the defendant is a resident and citizen of Buncombe County. The civil action regarding actions that occurred in Buncombe County in or about May 6th and 7th, 2023. Factual background: the plaintiff incorporates all the allegations. It states the plaintiff is a state-certified law enforcement officer and was working as a sworn deputy during that time. It states the defendant is a business owner of a landscaping company called Lawn and Order. So I will show you that in just a moment. But interestingly, so let me actually, I'll show you now. So Lawn and Order Landscaping, Lawn, like Law and Order, the TV show, I presume. This Facebook post from 2023 states Ryan Houston is a person who does the consulting, the planning, the proposals, and oversees most of the larger jobs. He's a Western North Carolina native and has 24 years experience with Western North Carolina plants and wildlife. So keep that in mind while we go through the court documents. On the website, under About Us, it says page not found. I presume they're updating their website if they, for whatever reason, need to. I'll leave it there. But so going back to the court filing from the deputy to Ryan Houston and defendant, it states the landscaping company name and says his vehicle may have been used, his vehicle may have been used for business. The defendant is married to Laura Houston and they own property and possess assets together, which are in North Carolina. The defendant owns a 2013 Ford Expedition with a VIN number listed. And then it states on or about the 6th and 7th of May, 2023, what we just went through, but adds very disturbing details, including the defendant became enraged at his wife, Laura Houston, and went to the home of a friend of Laura Houston, at which time he assaulted the male friend, causing facial fractures. After the initial assault, the defendant kicked and chased, excuse me, caused damage to a vehicle being operated by his wife while his children were inside the vehicle. The defendant left the location of his wife's friend, later to return to the friend's home, caused significant destruction to the home, and stole a firearm. The defendant thereafter went to the Buncombe County Magistrate's office on May 7, 2023, with a firearm and communicated threats to his wife. The plaintiff was on duty as a law enforcement officer at this time and attempted to converse with the defendant. Plaintiff, with the course of scope of his duty, attempted to de-escalate the situation. Defendant became further enraged at the plaintiff. The defendant pointed a gun at the plaintiff and shot the plaintiff. The defendant fired the first shot. The plaintiff did not know the defendant prior to these events. At no time did the plaintiff consent to, agree to, or want a gun pointed at him or to be shot by the defendant. At the time of the shooting, the plaintiff was put into fear for his life and bodily injury by the actions of the defendant. The plaintiff removed a service weapon from his holster and returned fire, and the defendant fled the area and was later captured, arrested, and hospitalized. At no prior times before these events had plaintiff been shot or shot at. The defendant acts by the defendant towards the plaintiff were willful, wanton, reckless, with the intent of killing, harming, and injuring the plaintiff. And it goes on to describe the when he saw it with serious injuries and so on. My understanding is that he was shot in the torso and healed from those wounds. Now, it goes into lengthy detail about gross negligence and so on. So that is a civil suit separate from the criminal charges, including damages and so on. So on, let's see, I believe this was yes, Friday, July 28, 2023, no charges for deputy and Buncombe County Magistrate's Office shooting. So going back to this week, no, I don't want to allow, hang on just a moment. Well, I really hate all these ads. It's very, not, let me pause a second. I was trying to show you another article from WYFF4, but their pop-up ads are just ridiculous and really has no new information. It's really interesting to me how mainstream media really just copy-paste information from press releases from sheriff's offices. So that's pretty much the latest I have as of 3:55 p.m. on Saturday, August 3rd, about what has happened this week. However, my investigation has found that a news article from 2013 involving Brian Houston, marriage proposal saga, a ring, cops, machine guns, handcuffs, and a yes. So I'm going to try to play that for you here. But it states Ryan Houston's meticulously planned wedding proposal included a private sunset dinner on a pier of a Mexican beach and a pre-made list of songs to be played at just the right moment. He never imagined that the actual proposal would include Mexican police, machine guns, and a diamond engagement ring sitting at the bottom of the ocean. I spent about 3 months planning this proposal, Houston said, told ABCNews.com. I sold my motorcycle to pay for the ring and cashed in some savings. I really went all out and researched the ring and diamonds. I researched online for weeks to find the perfect resort. He settled on the Secrets Aura Resort in Cozumel, Mexico. The couple would go there on vacation from their home in Weaverville, North Carolina, and he planned to pop the question on January 9th. On that night, Houston, 30, headed down to the beach with girlfriend Laura Urout, 28, for the surprise dinner. She was greeted at the beach with "I love you, Laura," spelled out in flower petals. Houston said the hotel's event coordinator had promised him that they would be the only ones on the pier and would have a great view of the sunset. But as they approached, he saw more than a dozen people at the pier, a yacht parked in a spot that blocked the view, and the hotel staff scrambling to set up the dinner. My heart just sank immediately, he said. We were supposed to be out there by ourselves watching the sunset, and that's the first thing I saw. From there, Houston said things worsened with delayed service, the music playing at the wrong time, and an obstructed view where instead of the sunset, all he could see was a man on the yacht smiling at him while wearing only a Speedo. The whole thing is pretty much blown, not going like it's supposed to. So my nerves are just shot, he said. Urout noticed that he was tense and suggested they untie the yacht and give it a push. Houston said it seemed like a great idea at the time, but now acknowledges that it was a mistake. After they shoved off the yacht, the Speedo-wearing man began shouting that it wasn't his boat and he was just watching it for his boss. Houston felt badly and said he helped the man tie the yacht back up. Disappointed with the entire situation, they left the dinner before their main course ever arrived and headed back to the hotel lobby. Just about that time, we see a Mexican police truck pull in, And they tell me police want to speak to me about damaging a yacht, and I'm thinking, you've got to be kidding me, he said. Houston said the boat's owner was jumping up and down, mad, insisting they arrest me. Before he knew it, Houston said he was handcuffed and telling Uriah to take his valuables, including the one she didn't know about. I've still got this 1.84 carat diamond ring safely pinned inside my shirt, and I have to make the decision either to go to Mexican jail with this ring or let Laura take it, he said. He told her to get one more valuable from inside his shirt. There on the pier, while I've got my handcuffs behind me, she reaches inside my shirt, feels the ring, and puts two and two together, he said. She gasps and pulls out the ring real hard, and the safety pin pops. The ring comes flying out of the shirt and then out of her fingers. It bounces off the dock and goes in the ocean. The police then began to take Houston towards their police truck. You're out was freaking out, Houston said. So that's all the written part of the story. Let me see if I can play the clip for you.
Ring is part of their Houston popped the question.
It's a great story to tell.
It was lovely Cozumel, or a year out's name in the sand at the Mexico resort. This is the couple before things went awry. Ryan spent big bucks in advance for what turns out to be terrible service, and of course, it's hard to ignore a guy on the yacht behind them.
He's been at once standing up in his feelings and stretching it on and giving a smile at me on her shoulder. And that was it. And that was just this moment on the camel's back. And that's the yacht right there. Went over and untied the boat. Wish me luck in the dock.
Then the owner of the yacht claims there was damage, so Mexican cops investigated.
What happened in situation? While he's finishing.
It was a nightmare.
In desperation, Ryan tells Laura to grab something in his pocket.
She felt me. She's on my shirt. I heard a gasp, and she jerked on it. And then I just heard her screech. It slipped out of her fingers and slipped into the ocean.
I immediately started flipping out. I started crying. I was making a scene. It was very emotional.
Then police realized no damage done, so Ryan is turned loose. Ryan then puts on his scuba gear and searches for the bling.
I wasn't gonna leave until I found it.
And you found it almost 2 hours later.
Went over to the group and let, and she didn't know I had it. I knelt down and proposed to her in my suit.
The answer is yes.
Very romantic.
Hope somebody likes it, somebody like.
So that's the tale of the proposal gone wrong that ended up going just right.
Same response, it's OMG.
Very interesting, considering all of the just awful, awful allegations that this man faces involving his wife and his children and everything else. So that was then, this is now. Let me finalize by sharing this information about what happened last night. So, some updates about the situation. Yesterday, there was a fiery crash in Mars Hill, which resulted in the death of two people. I'm told that it was a wrong way crash, and the person traveling in the correct direction was newly retired Town of Marshall Police Chief Thomas Michael Boone. Mike Boone tragically passed away on Friday evening in a car accident, the town of Marshall said earlier today in a Facebook post. It stated that he retired only 2 days ago. They said, "We are fortunate to have had Mike in our presence, both as a law enforcement officer and as our friend, and he would be deeply missed by all who knew him." So, more to come on that, but sources are telling news outlets, and including myself, that the crash has ties to the search for fugitive Ryan Ricky Houston. It has not been confirmed yet whether or not the individual who was driving, allegedly driving in the wrong direction, because State Highway Patrol haven't released that information yet. Now, going back to the timeline, on Thursday around 10:15 Thursday night, a North Carolina Highway Patrol trooper in McDowell County clocked a vehicle speeding on I-40 eastbound near Old Fort. Due to the high speed, the vehicle gained considerable distance on the trooper, who decided not to engage in a pursuit. The trooper, who continued traveling east, found the vehicle involved in a collision with a tractor trailer near Parker Paget Road. The driver, who was identified as Ryan Ricky Houston, fled. There was a passenger in the vehicle who medical aid was called to an assist call to assist. That doesn't make There's a passenger in the vehicle who medical aid was called to assist after News 13 sources said she was found with life-threatening injuries. That sentence really needs to be reworked, in my opinion. But as I reported already independently, that passenger was stabbed by Ryan Houston. That's what multiple law enforcement sources are stating. Then, shortly before midnight Thursday, McDowell County Sheriff's Office said Houston became the suspect of a home invasion. So we already went through all that. And then on Friday, the McDowell County Sheriff's Office issued warrants. Now, I support law enforcement to the best of my knowledge and ability. However, given the really heightened sense of something like this, there's a lot of questions I have as to why the delay. If something is happening, on a Thursday night, does it give law enforcement the ability to get warrants more quickly? I don't know the answer to that offhand, but it seems like other jurisdictions in larger areas who have more resources are able to respond quicker with warrants, and sometimes that can aid in apprehending a suspect more quickly. Again, I don't know that to be fact, but that is my opinion given my knowledge of covering police and policy and homeland security for 20 years. As many of you may, or some of you may not know, I got my start covering police after really on 9/11. I was in college as a sophomore in college on September 11th, 2001. So now in 2024, these policy and police issues about just investigation that seems to be never ending. So getting back to the timeline, again, Saturday today, North Carolina Highway Patrol confirmed that one of the drivers in that crash, which may or may not be related to the search for Ryan Houston, is newly retired Police Chief Mike Boone. So, Mike Boone has a very storied and interesting, really long career. But if in fact that this proves to be true, that Ryan Houston had something to do with that death and that crash, as well as the woman who he allegedly stabbed, that leaves a lot of questions as to why the judge and DA let him out. So I typically cover Rutherford County. Here is my recent story about Hunter Haynes, who is a narcotics detective who's seeking dual roles, cop and commissioner. There's really interesting things happening in law enforcement throughout Western North Carolina, so I encourage you to read it if you haven't already, and you can click on Learn More About Me to read my more about my background that I wrote. I need to probably update this. This was last updated. I believe I updated it in January. But again, I've been reporting on these issues for a long time, and I'm also the founding editor of Western NC Deaf Community, a public Facebook group where I cover deaf issues and lead discussions for ways for deaf people to get better access to news and information in the 19 counties of Western North Carolina, which spans several congressional districts. I was diagnosed with profound hearing loss when I was a child, and I'm an accessibility advocate, especially for use of closed captioning. So my interest in public policy and police not only covers basic public safety, as it should, but how people who are deaf can get better access to this news in real time and be more well-informed as a well-informed society. So please subscribe to Cops in Congress and follow my work. And of course, I will update my stories as new information emerges. I'm also on TikTok, Facebook, X, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Please take a look back at my past stories. There's lots of interesting news happening in Western North Carolina, and I really need your financial support to make that possible. So please consider becoming a paid subscriber. Thanks for watching. I will see you next time.